so good to be in the house of prayer one more time.
Amen.
Amen. God is so good. He woke us up early this morning. He gave us another opportunity for another day's journey. And we're just so happy and pleased about that. Well, he told us in his word, fail not to assemble ourselves together. And we have been obedient this morning. We have assembled ourselves together. And we know that he's in the midst. So we're going to go ahead and do our devotional, go through our devotional period, and get us ready for the worship service. So we come this morning to worship him in spirit and in truth. We're going to open our hymn books to page 30. We've come into this house. And that is one of the reasons we've come to this house, to serve him, to praise him, to lift up his holy name. Amen. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Page 30.
Spirit.
Yes.
For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnal minded is death, but to be spiritual minded is life and peace.
Yes.
I've read from chapter 8 of Romans, verses 1 through 6. May the Lord have a blessing on the readers, the hearers, and the doers of His holy word.
Amen.
May we pray. Most holy and wonderful God, Master, I just come to you just to say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Father God, for all of our wind down last night and our waking up this morning. Thank you, Father God, for granting each and every one of us with a reasonable portion of health and strength. I thank you for that, Father. Father God, I just thank you for your love, your mercy, and your kindness. But most important, Father God, I thank you for your Son, Christ Jesus, who died so each and every one of us can have everlasting life. Father God, I just thank you that I can call on his name. Because we know, Father God, there is power in the name of the Lord. There is power of healing in his name. There is power of forgiveness in his name.
Yes.
There is power of no fear in his name, Father God. For that, Father God, I just say thank you for that, Father God.
Yes, Lord.
Father God, I just thank you that we can come to you. We can come to you how we are, Father God.
Yes, Lord.
And that you can forgive us for each and everything that we have done, and we just repent and call on you, Father God.
Yes, Lord.
Father God, I just thank you, Father God,
thank you, Lord,
that only you can
you,
see our fault, but through that fault, Father God, that we can be raised through you, Father God. Father God, I thank you that you are our Savior, that
yes,
you are our Redeemer.
Yes,
and
Lord,
I thank you, Father God, for each and everything. I thank you, Father God, for new life.
Yes, Lord.
I pray, Father God, for this church in a whole. I pray, Father God, for each and every church that is opened up in thy name.
Yes,
but
Lord,
more important, Father God, I pray for those who have not yet found you as their Lord and Savior.
Yes, yes.
Because only you and only you can give each and every one eternal life.
Yes, Lord.
And this, Father God, I lift this prayer to you in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Forever and ever, and ever, and ever.
Amen. He deserves all the praises, all the honor, and all the glory. Come on, somebody. He woke you up this morning. You had food on the table this morning. You had a roof over your heads this morning. You are able to put clothes on your backs and shoes on your feet in a reasonable mind. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Amen. Amen. And before we get into the Word of God, I would like to welcome some visitors that we have here this morning. Amen.
Amen.
I'd like to welcome Manny and Maria Almanza. Almanza. Amen. And our brother here, Brother Hill, brother, he relocated from Dallas, Texas to here. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And I want to say welcome to New Life.
Amen.
Amen. And let me say this, that we are a church, we are a Bible teaching church.
Amen.
We don't compromise the gospel.
Amen.
We tell it just how Jesus told
Amen.
It.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. We don't compromise anything that's in regards to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. We preach the truth here, and we're not here to entertain people, but we're here to let the Word entertain people. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And let's sing our welcome song to our visitors. Amen.
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 Jesus in me, but Jesus in you. Jesus in me, but Jesus in you. Jesus in me, Lord, Jesus in you. You are so easy. You are so easy to love.
Amen.
God bless you. Amen.
Amen.
I'd also like to say happy birthday to our brother Jonathan Robinson. He's not here this morning, but just want to wish him a happy birthday. His birthday is on Tuesday. Amen. So just lift him up on your in your prayers on Tuesday morning. Amen.
Amen.
When you wake up, wishing him a happy birthday.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to get into this word this morning. Amen. And let me say, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Yes.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
We're able to see. Even though we saw all the smoke in the atmosphere, we were able to see. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. And let us be glad and rejoice in.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
Amen. So if you will, turn your Bibles to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. And we're going to continue on our series of what Jesus has to say to the churches. And this is the fifth church out of the seven churches, out of the seven churches that we're going to discuss. Amen. And we know Jesus had, seven letters to seven churches. And those churches reflect not only what was going on back then during John's day, but it also reflects what's going on in the churches today. Amen.
Amen.
And if you're there, please stand for the reading of God's word. And it reads, "And unto the angel of the church of Sardis write, These things said he that has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on as a thief. I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee, that thou hast a few names in Sardis which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white. For they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches."
Yeah.
You may be seated. May the Lord have a blessing on the readers, hearers, and most importantly, the doers of his holy word. Amen?
Amen.
And let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your most beautiful name. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. And we thank you for your love. But more importantly, Father, we thank you for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father, we just pray as your word comes forth, let it circumcise our heart and it search our hearts and create in us a clean heart so we may better serve you. And Father, we also pray if there's anything lacking in the church at New Life, Father, we just pray through your mercy and through your grace that you change or remove any obstacles that's between us and you in worship, Father, and being obedient to your word. Anything that's contrary to you, God, we just pray that you remove it.
Yes, Lord.
Giving you all the praises, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Now imagine you are crawling, scorched, near death across a hot, burning desert. I guess we could say we're in that predicament right now.
That's right.
Amen. And you are dying of thirst and close to perishing. But ahead you see a sign that reads, cool, clear, life-giving water, only 5 miles ahead. And this sign gives you renewed energy, new hope, and you continue your tormenting crawl across the parched sand. And as you arrive at the promised place, you see a magnificent building, radiant in its beauty, and the sign outside invites you in, even beckoning you with the promise of life-giving water. So you crawl through the entrance into this glorious building, and there before you is the promised well. And with the bucket ready to let down and filled with water to quench your thirst and to pour life back into your body. And with the last bit of your strength, you lower the bucket into the well, expecting the splash as the bucket hits the water, but it never comes. And the only sound is the dull thud of the bucket hitting the bottom of that well. And you think that perhaps you're just delirious, so you reel in the bucket only to find it full of dust. Dust that cannot quench your thirst, but dust that only deepens the thirst and destroys all hope. And this may sound far-fetched, but this is the experience of many people who goes to God's house expecting to be filled and fed with the water and bread of life, but go away feeling the same way they felt before they came in God's house. They leave just as thirsty and hungry because they were not fed. They find no help or no hope, or should I say, they leave the same way that they came in, empty and not full. And in some churches, the amen crowds have grown quiet. The shouting has become silent. The studying of the word of God is not important. And our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has been watered down to a mere man where no one is being saved. Say amen if you hear me.
Amen.
Some come as they are, but they leave the same way they came, not being fed.
Right.
Such was the condition of the church we are considering today. The church in Sardis had taken on the character or attributes of the city in which she resided. And to help you understand the condition of this church, we must first understand the condition of this city. You see, Sardis was the capital city of Lydia and was founded in about 1200 BC. Now, the original city sat on the top of a 1,500-foot high plateau, and there was one narrow road leading into the city. And the other sides of the plateau were just steep cliffs. And this city had one way in, and one way out, which made the city very safe and nearly impenetrable by invading armies, causing them to believe that they were always safe. Amen, somebody. So Sardis was also the home of Esau, whose fable we all heard as children, like the boy who cried wolf. the cat and mouse, and the goose that laid the golden eggs, to name a few. And at one time, Sardis had been one of the greatest cities in the world. It reached its peaks of success and power under King Croesus. King Croesus and Sardis were known around the world for their wealth. And in that part of the world, it is still common to hear the phrase, as wealthy as Croesus. While Sardis reached its peak of success under Croesus, it also fell under his reign. He and the people of the city became complacent and lazy in their wealth and their power and their city's apparent invisibility. But when you get to the point in your life where you feel like you're on top of the world, or you can't be touched, or like MC Hammer would say, you can't touch this, God will knock you off your high horse. You see, when you put so much into yourself and think you've done it all for yourself, God will knock you down. Because all he has to do is take the breath out of your body, and you're not able to do not one thing.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. And because the city of Sardis was invaded and conquered twice and never got back to the point they were before. Mm-hmm. And they were conquered twice due to complacency. Mm-hmm. The word says pride goes before the destruction, mm-hmm, and a haughty spirit before the fall.
Yeah.
The city was proud of its past. It was proud of its reputation, but its reputation was all that was left. For all intents and purposes, the city of Sardis was dead even while it lived. And apparently the church in Sardis had adopted the atmosphere of the city, and the church had become a thermometer that registered the temperature of the city instead of becoming a thermostat that changed the temperature of that city. And the church in Sardis had grown lazy, degenerate, immoral, and complacent. And the church was dying because of a lack of interest and concern for God. And allow me to say, just because you grew up in a certain environment does not mean you have to be a product of that environment.
Amen.
There's a saying that says you can't take a person out of the ghetto, but you can't take the ghetto out of the person.
Mm-hmm.
And let me say, I know a man named Jesus who will take you as you are and change you to what he wants you to be. Mm-hmm. He will take your filthy rags and turn them white as snow, because he is hope to the hopeless. Oh, y'all ain't hearing me.
Amen.
See, ain't none of us was born with Bibles in our hands and crosses around our necks.
Amen.
When we were born, we came into this world as sinners. And as soon as we were able to start talking as children, the first thing we did was be disobedient to our parents. Because I don't know about y'all, but for me, the first word was no to my parents when they told me to do something. And let me say, we came from filth. And we're told there were filthy rags. But Jesus took us in when we came to faith in him and adopted us into his family. You see, I don't know about you, but that makes me happy. That gives me joy, that gives me peace, that gives me strength, that gives me confidence in knowing that I belong to God.
Amen.
Amen. And not anything of this world. And when God can do that for me, he can do it for anybody else.
Yes.
Because like I said, he is hope to the hopeless.
Amen.
And let me say, this church in Sardis had become lazy and complacent that the Lord comes to them. As surely as the city of Sardis was dying, so was the church of Christ, and that city was dying. If Ephesus was considered a church that left its love for Christ, if Smyrna was a faithful church, Pergamos a fallen church, Thyatira a worldly church, then Sardis is considered a dead church. And I would like to preach on the topic, an autopsy of a dead church.
All right.
Amen.
And let me say, Jesus has no words of commendation for this church. But Jesus, the great physician, has a prescription for this dying church. And Jesus comes to this church in verse 1, and Jesus, the great physician, gives his pronouncement. And in verse 1, Jesus comes to this church as the one who has the seven spirits of God. Mm-hmm. As one who is holding the seven stars. Now, the seven spirits of God refers to the Holy Spirit and his complete ministry. For Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2 says, "And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, and the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, and the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord." So in Jesus' hand is the fullness of the Holy Spirit. And this is a reminder to the churches that we are to operate not under the power of human skills, leadership, and organization, but under the awesome power of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
You see, when the church walks in the power of the flesh, we will fail at everything we try to accomplish.
Mm-hmm.
But when we walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, there will be success that cannot be measured. There will be glory and there will be power and life in the believer instead of deadness and ineffectiveness. When the Spirit of God is in control of the members of the church, great things not can, but will be accomplished.
Yes, yes.
However, when the Holy Spirit is not in control, paralysis is the result.
Yes.
And nothing can be accomplished for God's glory.
Yes.
So we must submit, allow, and listen to the Holy Spirit, which is in our bodies, mm-hmm. so he can take charge of our lives.
Yes.
Right.
And the seven stars are the pastors or messengers of the church, according to Revelation chapter 1, verse 20. And they are the messengers who bring the people the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
How can they hear unless God sends a priest to preach to them? So Jesus appears as one who has everything the church needs to succeed. His Spirit has all the power the churches need. His word has all the direction his churches need. So Jesus is saying, if you will submit to me, you will find in me all you need to accomplish my mission in this world. And that is a mission the modern church needs today. And that is the message that the modern church needs today.
Mm-hmm.
Men are trying every method under the sun to reach sinners,
mm-hmm.
and to do the work of the church. But all the power we need is found in the fullness of the Holy Spirit,
yes.
and in the Word of God. What we need is not a new method, not a new way,
yes.
not a new direction, but a new desire to seek the fullness of the Holy Spirit and do everything according to the teachings of the Word of God.
Amen.
We do not need entertainment to draw people. We don't need gimmicks and gadgets to get them to come.
Yes.
We don't need to compromise who we are in Christ to keep the church full on Sunday morning. What we need is to be led by the Spirit, and be lifted up and lift up Jesus, and he will do the drawing. We're not soul winners, but we lead lost souls to Jesus Christ.
Yes, yes.
Jesus then tells them, "I know thy works." He comes as one who sees all and knows all.
Okay.
Amen. Ain't nothing you can hide from Jesus.
Amen.
He does not commend them for their works. He does not condemn them for their works either, because they were a dead church doing nothing. And this church was not a threat to Satan either, because this was a church with no life.
All right.
And Jesus merely tells them that he knows everything they are doing.
Yeah.
And he knows everything that they are not doing as well.
Amen.
So he knew that what this church in Sardis was doing then, and he knows what we're doing today.
Amen.
In the churches across this country and across this world. He sees all, and along with that, he knows the motives that drive us to do what we do. You see, he knows if we're trying to be seen, and he knows if we're trying to make it all about us.
Amen.
He sees us as a whole, and he sees the individual as well. He knows our heart, he knows everything we do, and he knows why we do them.
All right.
He knows if we're doing it for the Father's glory Or he knows if we're doing it properly.
Yes.
He knows if we love him or we're just pretending.
Yes.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
God knows everything that we're doing.
Amen.
Everything. And after Jesus' examination of this church, he proclaims his prognosis, or diagnosis, amen? And apparently their works gave them the appearance of life, but Jesus tells them that they had that reputation. They were a busy working church with a great reputation among men. From all outward appearances, this church was everything a church ought to be.
Mm-hmm.
They may have believed that they were doing the right things, and they may have been busy to do good all over the community.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus does not commend them on anything
and
that they are doing, which tells you and I they are not doing the Lord's work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If we look at the previous churches, Jesus gave commendations, amen, somebody, and he gave condemnations.
Yeah.
Which means at least those churches was doing something. This church wasn't doing nothing. They had taken on the character or attribute of the city.
Amen.
They had become complacent and lazy.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't witnessing to anybody.
Already.
They weren't getting in any lives leading people to Christ.
Already.
They weren't doing anything but just enjoying their wealthy state.
Already.
And this church may have had a beautiful church building. They may have had standing room only inside the church.
Mm-hmm.
They may have had beautiful singing from the choir, and they may have been preaching the gospel message. Everyone who saw them looked at them and said, that church is on fire. And I'm sure that when people moved into Sardis from other towns, their pastor suggested that they visit this church in Sardis. It had all the appearance of life, but things were not as they seemed. Because the great physician placed his finger on the pulse of this church and he pronounced them dead. So no matter what others thought, Jesus knew the truth. And regardless of what others may have thought about this church, Jesus knew the truth. And he tells them that even though everyone thinks they are alive, they are in fact dead. And this word means just what it says, like a dead man. The church of Sardis were destitute of force or power. They were ineffective and inoperable. They were dead. There was activity, but it was not spiritual in nature. There was busyness, but they were bringing nothing eternal to pass. They were preaching, but lives were not being changed, and sinners were not being saved. They were busy, but they were operating in the energy of the flesh and not the energy of the Holy Spirit.
Yes, yes.
Everyone looked at them and spoke of their life and said, this is a church on fire. But Jesus, the one who knew them better than anyone else, looked at them and pronounced them dead. And allow me to say, you can't always believe what your eyes see, because looks are deceiving.
Yes. That's right, Pastor. Yes.
Amen.
You see, flowers on a table have all the appearance of life. They are beautiful, they are filled with color and fragrance, but they are dead because they have been removed from the roots in the ground that gave them life. See, and it won't be many days until their colors fade, their blooms wilt, and their leaves turn brown, and they will be taken and thrown into the trash.
Yes.
They look alive, but they are dead. And if a church is not rooted or anchored in Jesus, if their foundation is not in the uncompromised gospel, that is a dead church. Many churches are in the same shape today. They have all the appearance of life, but the great physician who has his finger on their pulse has declared them dead. I don't care how much money you got in your bank account as a church. I don't care how many members you got sitting in the pews. If you're not focused and anchored and looking to Jesus for everything, you are a dead church.
Yes.
If you're not proclaiming the gospel outside these four walls, you are a dead individual.
Yes.
It's just that simple.
Yes. Amen.
You see, we're here to lift up Christ. So he can draw all men, women, boys, and girls.
Yes.
Amen. You see, we should never be in a stalemate or be complacent where we don't feel like lifting him up.
All right.
You see, at least God gives us an opportunity to sleep and rest. But my Lord and Savior never rests.
All right.
And if he never rests, neither should we.
Amen.
Spiritually, we should be telling somebody about the goodness of Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
We should be a church on fire when we come on this place on Sunday to worship him.
Amen.
We should be hearing the amens and the hallelujahs, the testimonies, the pep in our step and the glads in our stride.
Yeah.
When we come together as a church to worship the one who saved us.
Yes.
And let me ask you, if Jesus puts his finger on New Life Today's pulse, my question is, will he declare us dead or alive? And I'm just not talking about New Life. I'm talking because we know the body of Christ is the church, not a building.
Yes.
So everybody who's saved in this building, if Christ was to put a pulse, his finger on your pulse, would you be dead or would you be alive? Would you be out proclaiming the word or hiding in the closet? Come on, somebody. And allow me to say that a dying church rests on its past accomplishments and is satisfied with its present state of complacency. A dying church is more concerned about their rituals and their formalities than they are about their spiritual well-being.
Yes.
A dying church is more concerned about social change than they are about seeing people changed by the power of God.
Yes.
A dying church is more concerned with material and monetary growth than it is with spiritual growth.
All right.
A dying church is more concerned with packing the seats and pleasing the men and women than it is with pleasing God.
Yes.
A dying church clings more tightly to its creeds and confessions than it does to the word of God. A dying church is one that evolves with the times and loses its conviction and compromise to God. But a church that has life is more concerned about spiritual growth and not numerical growth. A church that has life is more concerned about harmony within the membership than separation.
Amen.
A church that has life is more concerned about each other than individual self.
Right.
Because a living church is an emotional church.
Yes.
There will be times when we will laugh together, we will weep together,
yes,
we'll shout together, we'll sing together, we'll hurt together, and we'll pray together. A living church is an emotional church, which means we care about each and every one of us.
Yes.
Right. A church that has life is more concerned about being active in the world than doing the work of the Lord than just being pew sitters. Come on, somebody. I think I'm going to get a lot of amens in the sermon, because what I'm saying is that we need to be busy doing what God has called us to do.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
We're at the end of the road right now, my brothers and sisters. We can see prophecy being filled all around us right now.
Mm-hmm.
Matthew 24. And we need to get out of our slumber. We need to get out of our slothfulness and go tell somebody about Jesus.
Yes.
And you can start with your family.
Yes.
And then you can start with your friends.
Yes.
Because the thing is, time is running out, my
yes,
brothers and
yes,
sisters.
Yes.
Satan is on his way back. And somebody needs to know that Jesus saves lives.
Yes.
They need to know he died on the cross,
yes,
for the sins of the world.
Huh?
And that they can go to him in faith and he will save them out of their miserable condition.
Yes.
So let me ask you, do you have signs of life, my brothers and sisters? So Jesus, the great physician, gives his pronouncement. And in verses 2 through 3, the great physician gives his prescription. The church of Sardis is in a sad condition, but not all is lost. And that's what I love about my Savior. We may have messed up, screwed up, or choked up, but he gives us a way out.
Amen. Amen.
And let me say, it appears that there is still hope for this church as Sardis to make some changes and get back where they need to be. So Jesus prescribes a prescription to be watchful. Literally, this means that they are to chase sleep. And this church is a church with a glorious past. They have allowed their past success to numb them into a state of complacency and spiritual slumber. Jesus calls upon them to chase away sleep and wake up and realize that the victories of yesterday are not significant for today. In other words, Jesus is saying, you may have done some things in your past, but what have you done for me lately in kingdom building?
Yes.
You see, the people of Sardis would have understood exactly what Jesus was talking about when he said, be watchful. Mm-hmm. And as I mentioned earlier, Sardis was located on the top of a mountain. Mm-hmm. It had one way in and one way out, which was on the southern side. Therefore, all they had to do was put a guard detail at that one place to watch that city. But on two occasions in their history, they had been invaded by their enemies because they had felt secure, believing that the hill would not be overtaken. And with that thinking of being secured, the guards went to sleep on the job. So on two occasions, this city was captured by Cyrus and Antiochus the Great because the guards were asleep. Mm-hmm. And let me say, when we allow ourselves to sleep because of what we have enjoyed in the past, right, we're going to find ourselves conquered by the enemy as well.
Amen.
This happens far too often in churches. A church will struggle in its beginning, and the core group who God used to establish that church will have to work, pray, witness, give, and yield to God to see the church stay alive. But over time, more people may come in, more money may come in, buildings are built, and good services are enjoyed. Yet in the midst of all these good things, something terrible happens. The church begins to lose the vision that made them so strong in their early years. They become content to sit back and enjoy the fruits of their labor. And while we ought to be thankful for what the Lord has done for us, we should never reach a place where we let up and go to sleep.
Amen.
You see, there is no time to look back to yesterday, because our vision ought to be for today and for tomorrow. There is no time to fall asleep, because the Bible tells us God never sleeps.
Yes.
And we should not go to sleep spiritually in the things of God.
Yes.
We must fight the tendency to become still, satisfied, complacent, and showing a lack of interest in the things of God.
Yes.
The Lord also prescribes a prescription to this church to work. Now the Lord gives this church four activities that they are to be busily engaged in. He says, strengthen. And that word means revive the things which remain. He tells them that not everything about them has died. There are some things that have a spark of life in them. These things are to be revived before they die out. And the phrase that are ready to die literally means they are knocking on death's door.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a call for them to get stirred up again for the things of God. It is a call for revival. For I have found not thy works perfect before God. And this means that their works are incomplete, but more importantly, they don't reach heaven. They have done some things in their midst that are good, but they are works that need reviving before they will make an eternal difference.
Yes.
They were singing, praying, preaching, and giving, but their works were not reaching heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And they were accomplishing nothing of eternal value. They were dead people doing dead works.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It is possible to be busy in the things of God and yet to be doing nothing for God.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
Y'all get that?
Yes.
Just because you're cleaning around the church, just because you're doing things to a building, does not mean that it's good works.
Yes, right. Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Good works is when I can go tell somebody who hates God that God loves them.
Yeah, yeah.
Good works is when I go boldly before anybody who don't believe in God and proclaim the gospel message.
Yes.
Good works is when even though they despise me, hate me, talk bad of my name, I can still love them.
That's right.
Amen. Amen, Pastor.
Those are the good works. Amen. Not what you do around the church. It's what you do for Christ that matters. It's what you do for Christ that's going to last forever.
Amen.
So, what churches like this deed in Sardis is to be stirred up by the Spirit of God into new life and activity for the glory of God. See, we want to let the flesh do the leading, but my suggestion to you is let the Holy Spirit do the leading.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen.
When you allow Him to take over your life and you submit to Him, God's glory, God will get the glory.
Yeah.
Amen. Because nothing about this flesh is good.
That's right.
Nothing about us is good. But thank God that He placed His Spirit in us so we can do good.
Yeah.
Now the second prescription is to remember, therefore, how thou hast received and heard. These people are counseled to remember where the Lord has brought them from and what He has done for them. They are to remember the days when they served the Lord out of a joyful heart and wanted more than anything to do His will. They are to remember what it was like to walk in the power of God while the fire of His glory burned in and through them for His glory. And let me say, memory can be a bad thing, especially when our memories cause us to live in the past and rest on past glories. However, if memory wakes us up and causes us to be resurrected in the present, then memory serves a great purpose.
Amen.
You see, my brothers and sisters, what I'm saying, if we remember anything, let us remember how He made a way for us. Let us remember how He healed our bodies. Let us remember how He took away the alcohol and drug addictions. Let us remember it could have been, it should have been, and it would have been us.
Yes.
But God's grace got us through. And the third prescription is to hold fast.
Yes.
This church is told to hold on to the things that are still alive in their midst. They're to settle the problem before the Lord and not allow those things to die as well. There's always a danger in focusing our attention in one area or another. We must not revive one thing while we allow the other thing to die.
Yeah.
Y'all get that?
Yeah.
So doing so leaves us in the same condition we're already in. You see, what we are looking for is a total transformation that preserves the living things and revives the dead things in us. Okay.
Amen.
Amen. And the last prescription is to repent. In this verse, they are confronted concerning their sin. When the things of God are allowed to die, the only resources the church has is repentance.
Yeah.
And the ideal of repentance is a foreign one to many in our day and time. People seem to have the opinion that whatever they want to do is just fine and should be accepted by everyone. Yeah. But God is not obliged to accept the things you do. Come on, somebody. Because He is the creator of the heavens and the earth.
Yes.
Amen. He created each and every one of us.
Yes.
And He don't have to tolerate sin because He is a holy God.
Yes.
And while there is sin in the life of an individual, there must be repentance before there could be restoration and revival. The same is true for the church. When a church has allowed itself to fall asleep on God or into a state of slumber, their only hope is to repent, a change of mind, and a change of direction. When we turn away from our sins and we turn to God, repentance is a change of mind that results in a change of action.
Yes.
How long has it been since we as individuals and we as a church have repented before the Lord for our laziness, our complacency, our lack of interest, our wickedness, and our deadness. You see, we have been made alive in Christ, and we should live as such. Mm-hmm. And if this church in Sardis don't get it together, and if the modern day churches don't get it together, Jesus has promised, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. So this church is told that they will not do the serious work of changing themselves. The Lord himself will come into their midst and take away the things that remain alive. And that church will be totally and fully dead. And like a thief, he will come in and take the best, and they will not even know when he comes and when he goes. They will be in a state of total death. And many churches are in that very condition today. When the call to repentance came from the Lord, they ignored it and he came to them in swift judgment. Now they function the same way they always had. They have services, they have preaching, they have outreach ministries, they give to the missions, but they are dead. They are ineffective. They are merely going through the motions, so to speak. There is no life in their midst, and Jesus has pulled the plug from their life support machine.
Yes.
And has pronounced them dead. And the Lord has written, the glory is departed from this church. Mm-hmm. It was once alive, but now it is dead. Mm-hmm. Over the front door. Mm-hmm. So, my brothers and sisters, we need to be about the Father's business.
Yeah. Yeah.
We need to be about telling somebody. We need to be about being obedient to his word. We need to be about praying daily. We need to be about studying his word daily. We need to be about living our life for Jesus Christ. Because he will come. Right where you see the new light, right above these doors, and put, this church was once alive, but now it's dead.
Yeah.
We need to do what God has called us to do.
Yeah.
And not be in a slumber, nor fall asleep. Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
So the great physician gives his pronouncement. The great physician gives his prescription. And in verses 4 through 6, the great physician gives his promises. As bad as things were in Sardis, there were a few names who were saved and seeking to serve the Lord. They are giving the Lord promise that they will walk with the Lord in white.
Mm-hmm.
They have lived out the truth in this world, and they can be confident that they will share his glory in that world. Mm-hmm. While white clothing was worn in Roman times during festivals and times of celebration. It was a symbol of purity, victory, and festivity. And likewise, Jesus is saying, you folks are standing faithful. You have not defiled your garments with the deadness that exists all around you. You are saved and you are serving. One day you will walk with me in heaven, and it will be a time of victory, hostilities, and purity. That is Jesus' promise to all those who are saved by his grace. Jesus was talking to them back then, and he's talking to the world today. If you will repent and turn to him, the same shall be clothed in white raiment.
Yes.
And Jesus goes on to say, I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. They will be made secure in this relationship with him. And by the way, God is not saying that he blots out names who are already placed in the book. Let me see if I can explain this to you. Once you come to faith in Jesus Christ, you are his and he is yours. And can't nobody take you from him. And let me say, this verse is often used by people who try to say that Christians can lose their salvation. But I'm here to tell you, based on what said the Lord,
mm-hmm.
This verse does not serve as a threat of loss, but it serves as a verse of assurance.
Yeah.
It serves as a promise, a precious promise of absolute security to all those who believe in Jesus Christ. You see, we don't serve a God who saves us today and will lose us tomorrow.
Yeah,
we slip up.
Yeah.
We don't serve a God who said you were good today, but you were bad yesterday, and I got to let you go.
Amen.
But we serve a God
yeah.
who says, I have you in my hand.
Yeah.
My Father has you in his hand,
yeah.
and no man, no woman, no saint, nobody can draw take you from them.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. We don't serve a conditional God.
Mm-hmm.
We serve an unconditional God
yes.
who loves all of us.
Amen.
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 Even the sinner, he loves.
Yes.
And we're up under grace right now, and he's asking them, he wants them to come in.
Amen.
But if they don't come in, there's going to be a price to pay.
Amen.
You see, we can't pray them out of nowhere when they die.
Amen.
And that's why we need to be busy about telling people today why they're still alive.
Amen.
That's right.
And also, let me say, like I said, it serves us, we know that we are absolutely secure in Jesus Christ. And you don't have to take my word for it, but we can go straight to the scriptures.
Yes.
For the word of the Lord says, for God so loved the world,
yes.
that he gave his only begotten Son,
yes.
that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have yes. eternal life.
Yes.
It doesn't say may or I think about it, it says, shall have eternal life.
Yes.
And the word says, these things I have written unto you who believe in the name of the Son of God.
Yes.
So that you may know that you have eternal life.
All right.
Yes.
That's a promise.
Yes.
The word says, for I am convinced
yes.
that neither death nor life,
yes.
nor angels, nor yes. principalities,
yes.
nor things present, nor things to come, nor power, nor height, nor depth,
yes.
nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus,
Amen.
Our Lord.
Amen.
So if God said it, it settles it.
Yes.
Can't nobody take us away from Jesus.
Amen,
Amen somebody.
Amen.
But at the same time, we don't need to be complacent knowing that either. We need to be on fire for the Lord. We need to be moving for the Lord. We need to be telling for the Lord. We need to be doing things that God has called us to do.
Yes.
We should not just stay inside these four walls of the church and come out here on worship Sunday and that be it. And Monday from Saturday, we ain't telling nobody about Jesus. But Monday through Saturday, we ain't studying the Word of God. We need to live our life for Christ.
Amen.
And let me say, when you and I were saved, our names were written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Jesus said in Luke chapter 10, verse 20, that this was the real reason for rejoicing. You see, not that job promotion you just got, not your big bank account, that nice car, or that fancy house that you live in, you should be rejoicing about. But we should be rejoicing about that we are saved
yes.
and have been adopted
yes.
in Jesus' hand, and we're saved forever.
Yes, Lord.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And when you're in Jesus' hands, he is yours.
Amen.
He says, I will confess his name or her name before my Father and before his angels. So a day is coming when Jesus will usher us, the redeemed ones, into the presence of the host of heaven and say, this one is mine. They were not ashamed of me, and I'm not ashamed of them. They were faithful over a few things.
Right.
They sought me for direction. The decisions were based upon my word. When they were in despair, they called upon my name.
Right.
When they were lost, they looked for me. When they cried out, I heard their voices.
Yes.
So they are mine. They belong to me, and I'm not ashamed to call them my brothers and sisters, sons and daughters of God the Father. But if you're ashamed to go tell somebody about him, he's going to be ashamed to tell his Father about you. You see, the majority of the people in the church in Sardis were not just cold, but out of God's will, they were lost and dead sinners in the need of salvation. You see, Jesus comes to them to give them an opportunity to be saved. And it might sound prideful and arrogant, but I'm convinced that most churches are filled with lost sinners.
Yes.
They go through the motions, but they are merely practicing dead works. And churches in that shape do not need a revival, they need a resurrection. Come on, somebody. They need to be brought back to life. And I know I say this and I say it time and time again, but prosperity preaching does nothing for me. Amen. Naming and claiming does nothing for me. Amen. Telling everybody that everybody's going to heaven does nothing for me. Amen. What I'm saying, my brothers and sisters, when you go through the motions, your works are dead. When you're lying to people about this and that about Scripture, which is not Scripture, you are dead. And you will become dead if you're listening to it. Come on, somebody. We need to know the truth. We need to know what Jesus wants us to do. And if you go to Matthew 28, it's rather easy what he wants us to do. And that's to go and tell somebody.
That's right.
And let the Holy Spirit tell you what else you're supposed to do through your spiritual gifts. Amen.
Amen.
And let me say, or let me ask you, are you living for Jesus or are you dying? Mm-hmm. Are you sharing the word? Mm-hmm. Are you living the word? Mm-hmm. Are you being obedient to the word? Mm-hmm. Let me say, are you telling somebody? He will be the way for the lost. He will be the life of the dead. He will be the truth to the liar. He will be the amen in prayer. He will be the door to the lost sheep. He will be the bread of life for the hungry and the living water for the thirsty. Come on, somebody. Are you telling somebody? That he is the order in chaos. He is the solution to their crisis. He is the hope in their despairment. And he is the power in their weakness.
Yes.
Are you telling somebody?
Yes.
He was crucified on a barred cross. He was buried in a barred tomb.
Mm-hmm.
But after 3 nights and 3 days in the grave, he got up and defeated the grave, death, and Satan himself for the sins of this world.
Yes.
Are you telling somebody?
Yes.
He is the hope for the hopeless.
Yes.
He is the burden bearer for the heavy laden. He is the shelter of safety. He's the bridge over troubled water.
Yes.
Are you telling somebody about Jesus?
Yes.
You see, have you tried him, my brothers and sisters?
Yes.
Have you tried him for yourself? And some people will tell you he's all right.
Yes, he is.
Some people will tell you he's altogether loving.
Yeah.
Some people will tell you he's just, I know Jesus, he's done some things for me. But I'm here to tell you, he's my everything.
Yes.
He's my water when I'm thirsty.
Yes.
He's my food when I'm hungry.
Yes.
He's my pep in my step when I don't want to feel like it. He's the one that gives me life. He's the one that gives me hope.
Yes.
He's the one that gives me peace.
Yes.
He's the one that gives me joy.
Yes.
He's the one that wakes me up every morning praising his name.
Yes.
You see, what I'm trying to say, my brothers and sisters, he provides me with everything that I need.
Amen, Pastor.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
You see, he is more than just a name to me. He is more than the one who healed my body of cancer 18 years ago. He's more than somebody who made a way for me when I couldn't make a way for me or my family.
Yes.
He's more than anything to me, my brothers and sisters.
Yes.
I know what he's done in my life.
Yeah.
And you know what he's done in your life.
Oh, yeah.
So go and tell somebody about what he's done for you.
Yeah.
Go and tell somebody how Jesus made a way for you. Go and tell somebody how Jesus saved you.
Amen.
You see, we do not need to be declared dead.
Amen.
And the church is dead when they're dead, not doing God's work.
Mm-hmm.
And when we look at the church of Sardis, that's what the whole problem is. They weren't doing nothing in regards to God's work.
Mm-hmm.
They might have been doing everything else.
Mm-hmm.
They might have been having live, great services and standing room and everything else in the building.
Mm-hmm.
But God don't care about that. God cares, and let me say, he cares about it, but he cares more about you proclaiming the gospel, telling somebody about his son,
amen,
so people can be saved, because he wants no one to perish.
Amen.
We got to go outside these four walls and start sharing this. It's not a secret that should be kept inside the building, but it should be a word that's told to everybody.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
So let us not be dead in the things of God, but let us be alive, because he has called us to be alive. Amen?
Yeah.
And there's always the danger that any church can die. There's a story written by this man where he wrote it this way. Dennis Lyle said it eloquently. Tragically, many churches are dead, like the rotting body of Lazarus. These church bodies have the foul stench of death upon them. They have the appearance of life, but they are in actuality dead. Their sanctuary is a morgue with a steeple, and their congregation are a group of corpses. They have undertakers for ushers, embalmers for elders, and morticians for ministers. Their pastors graduated from the cemetery. Their choir master is the local coroner, and they sing embalmed in Gilead. At the rapture, they will be the first churches to be taken, for the Bible says, the church dead in Christ shall rise first. Amen. So my brothers and sisters, the great physician has placed his finger on the pulse of this church and on that of every member in this church. What does this touch reveal about us? Does this touch reveal that we are alive in him? Or does it reveal that we're dead in him? And I want to challenge each and every one of you to examine yourself and see where you stand with God. Amen. See if you're doing what God has called you to do. And if you need saving, don't waste another day. You can come to the altar right now and confess with your mouth Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. And know in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. And my brother tells me that you shall be saved.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
Not if or maybe, but you shall be saved. Amen. Just know, whatever you need, God has it for you. You know, we put so much faith in everything in man, but man can't do nothing for people. Jesus Christ has done everything for you. Amen. And as the choir comes, I just want to say, just examine yourself. Examine yourself. And look at your family. Look to your family and see who needs the word of God in their life. Look to your family, look to your friends and see who are not saved so they can come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's how you let your light so shine before men and women so God can get the glory. Amen? I'm going to ask everyone to stand, please. And like I said, if you need prayer, you may come. If you need, would like to come from a candidate for baptism, if you would like to become a member of New Life Missionary Baptist Church, you can come. Amen.
Amen.
Like I said, as the choir comes forward, whatever you need, just know it's all in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The doors of the church are open.
Ah.
doors have been opened.
God be with you. God be with you. God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Have a blessed week. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Hill.